People, you don't know already, it's your boy Tango Leaders.
It's your girl Inez Chanel.
It's King Drewski of the War Boys. November 6th
to November 30th, yeah?
All roads lead to
Bacchanal de Afrique Afro Festival,
coming to you live, virtually, and on the ground.
You don't want to miss this, Medu. You cannot afford to miss it.
Remember me say, you know,
Bacchanal de Afrique.com. So, bonana kona.
Can't wait. Oh.
Unfortunately, my private jet just stopped working yesterday for no reason. So I have decided to use my Legatis Benz. I have decided to use my Lexus. Because we can't be stopped. We move.
Good evening, passengers. This is your captain speaking. First, I would like to welcome you aboard Flight Bacchanal de Afrique. May soon come with service from wherever you are to Planet Bacchanal. We will be taking off just as soon as I get through page 419 of this flight manual. We are currently cruising at an altitude of 420,000 feet at an airspeed of 20 miles per hour. The time is what you say it is. The weather looks funky and the tailwind acting up. We don't know when we will reach our destination because we are still waiting for fuel. So if anyone has some to donate, please let us know. Once we get going, the flight should take about 9 hours. But luckily, I know a shortcut. Just trust me. We are pleased to have some of the best cabin crew in the industry. Unfortunately, none of them are on this flight. Prior to takeoff, the cabin crew will be walking up and down the aisle to make sure that you didn't cheat on your taxes last year and to offer you a light snack and beverage. And the in-flight movie will begin shortly after that. I'll talk to you again before we reach our destination. Until then, sit back, relax, enjoy your flight, or you can sit up and be tense. That's your business.
Good evening, passengers. On behalf of the crew, I ask that you please direct your attention to the monitors above as we review the emergency procedures. There may be 99 ways to leave your lover, but there are only 2 ways out of this spacecraft. If you don't like humor, we have exits. Take a minute to locate the exit closest to you. Note that the nearest exit may be behind you. Count the number of rows to this exit. Should the cabin experience sudden pressure loss, stay calm and listen for instructions from the cabin crew. Oxygen mask will drop down from above your seat. Place the mask over your mouth and nose, like this. Pull the strap to tighten it. If you are traveling with children or someone who is acting like a child, please do us all a favor and put your own mask on first, then assist the other passenger. Unless it's my ex or a politician, then don't bother. In the unlikely event of an emergency landing and evacuation, just think of an incredible story you'll be able to go live with on social media. Your seat cushions can be used for flotation. In the event of emergency, water landing, please take them with our compliments. Life rafts are located below your seat and emergency lighting will lead you to the closest exit and slide. We ask that you make sure that all carry-on luggage is stowed away safely during the flight. Please refrain from smoking until you reach a designated smoking area, which for California is Las Vegas. While we wait for takeoff, please take a moment to review the safety data card in the seat pocket in front of you. Good luck understanding or remembering any of that information when you need it. We are now going to dim the lights for takeoff. If you are scared of the dark, oh well.
All righty. That music was jamming. That
That got my nerves down. That got me ready for today's artist talk. How about you, Brian?
Yeah, it was an entire party going on here. Silent party, silent disco, you know. Just comfortably moving in your chair.
Yes.
I know, right?
Giving the audience a little two-step.
Yes.
And I'm so excited for today. I am Aja Kuma. I'm going to be one of your MCs today. Myself, I'm an artist, singer, and songwriter from New York by way of Ghana. And Brian, let the people know where you're from.
My name is Brian, and my creative expression is I'm a visual artist, photographer, and creative director and stylist from Nairobi, Kenya. Born and bred here, and I'm glad to be with you guys.
Nice. Today we have so much in store for the people. We have a handful of artists today who are going to be able to talk about their projects for the festival that is on bacchanaldayafrique.com if you haven't seen already throughout November. So we're going to get to learn a little bit more about them, and we're going to be able to kind of just dig deeper into their souls and spirits and just learn about them and their art. And Brian, how about let the people know about some of the little activities we have today, where they can engage with the artists and how they can kind of, you know, connect with us.
So we have a Padlet where people can post inspirational quotes that they get to hear from the artist. We're live on Facebook and YouTube. So for the audience, if you have any questions, any comments, if you'd like to get to know more about the artist, you can shoot your questions there. We have our lovely hosts who will be taking the questions and passing them on to us. Yeah.
Yes. So you're going to get a lot of interaction from us. So without further ado, we're going to go ahead and have the artists introduce themselves. So we're going to start off with Traboli. Go ahead and let us know your claim to fame.
Thank you, Agakioma. My name is Traboli. I'm from Nairobi, Kenya, by way of Nakuru. I'm a rapper and a poet and an artist. I'm made of wordplay and word playgrounds and pilau and my mother's wisdom and pure potential and power naps. Just a little bit of power naps. Thank you.
I'm really digging your shot. The drip is immense, man.
Thank you, man.
It's a tunnel.
Yeah. Thank you.
Next, we have lovely lady Yvonne.
Oh, thank you. Hi, my name is Yvonne, and I am a sculpturist. I'm actually a guerrilla sculpture artist. I love to just put things down wherever I think I need to start conversations, and it's usually in a public space. And my pronouns are she and her, and I am made of sugar and spice and all that's nice.
Ooh, love it, love it, love it, love it. I'm all about that.
Yeah.
And next we have Dami Lola.
Hi, my name is Dami Lola Nofua. My pronouns are he, him. I'm a documentary photographer and filmmaker from Lagos, Nigeria. And I am made from sand, blood, sea, sky, and a whole lot of creativity. Nice to meet you guys.
That's what's up. Next on the list, we have Tapiso.
Greetings, noble sons and daughters of the African soil. My name is Tapiso Mabula Kandongeni. I am a documentary photographer and a writer. My claim to fame is that I give warm hugs, I make beautiful photographs, and I help to topple fascist governments. I'm made of revolution, I'm made of song, I'm made of all things beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you, beautiful.
Thank you.
And then Demetrius from Vermont, let us know.
What's going on, everybody? I am Demetrius. My pronouns are he and him. I'm coming at you from Middlebury, Vermont. And Vermont is a little state above New York City and below Canada. If nobody knows where that is. I am a multimedia producer. I like taking photos. I like doing filmmaking, documentary, commercial, all sorts of stuff. I made from a little bit of Jamaican oxtail, some Norwegian Northern Lights, California sunshine, and some Vermont maple syrup.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Demetrius. Next on the list, we have Kiazi.
Good morning, good evening, good night. My name is Kiazi Malonga from Congo. I live in the Bay Area. My form of expression through art is I am a percussionist that plays primarily the ngoma that captures rhythms from the Congo Kingdom, being Congo Brazzaville, Congo Kinshasa, Angola, and in a few other areas geographically there. I am made from smiles, laughter, intensity, music and vibrations that pierce your physical being and touch you deep down inside. It's a pleasure to be here with you guys today.
And he's not kidding with the intensity. If you saw the artist takeover a couple of days ago, him and his boys were beating those drums like it was no one's business. He was sweating it out. So he's serious about the intensity. And now we have the beautiful Ifeomi.
What up, though? I'm Ifeomi, and I want to invite you to take a deep and loving breath. For some grounding. I know I needed that. So I'm Ifeomi. My pronouns are she, her. I am from Detroit, Michigan, and I'm made of moons, fire, water, ritual, Black memory, Black futures, a lot of Venus energy, and 70s aesthetics.
Thank you, Fayomi, thank you. Next on the list, we have Taylor.
Hi, my name is Taylor, she, her. I am from New York, live in Oakland, but I'm right back in New York right now. As you can see, my grandmother's wallpaper and ambiance in the back. And so that's what I'm made up of right now. I'm in my childhood home, my mom's childhood home, my grandparents coming to age home, and our whole family has been in and out of this house. So I'm full of the ancestry that is very much so alive in all the ways.
Nice. Yes, that's my New York sister right there. I'm glad you are back over here. And I know family is going to be a big part of your project, which we're going to discuss more later. So I'm glad you brought that up. And last and certainly not least, we have the wonderful, the talented, the exquisite Afatasi, the artist.
Malo le soifua, olo o ingoa, Afatasi the artist. Hi everyone, my name is Afatasi the artist. My pronouns are she and her. I am born and raised in beautiful San Francisco, California. Yee! I am made of hyphia stardust and coconuts.
Beautiful, beautiful. And if you don't know, this is our last, very, very last artist talk. So we're definitely going to end it off with the bang. You know, we're going to end it off with the bang. We're going to have some fun and we're really going to get into some things. So without further ado, we're going to get into some questions. Brian, you want to go ahead and ask the first one?
Yeah. The first question to Tra and the rest of the artists is, how did you stumble, how did your creative journey begin? And where do you see your journey going?
So my journey began as an artist when I discovered my mom's poetry books. We used to travel a lot from house to house, different town to different town. And one day while we were moving around, as we were unpacking, I found some of her poetry. And I was like, she never told me she wrote poetry. And then from there, that that made me love words. And I realized someone could express themselves in very interesting ways. And then from there, I fell in love with hip hop, the old Kanye and Mos Def and Black Star and all these things. And the rest is history. And now I'm at Planet Buck now. Yeah.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you. Would you say most of your work is influenced by your mom's poetry book?
In the beginning, and then I had to have my experience. Like you can borrow at some point, but then you have to define yourself. So that was just like the springboard. And then I went and lived my life. I had breakups. I had all these things that happened to me. I had life becoming an adult and all these things. So that became myself, my own story. From there, I started defining who I am as a person. But that was just a springboard.
Okay. Yvonne.
So I'd say that my journey began with the color of my skin, with the kink in my curl, with the sex organ that I have, being a woman. And from there, you know, life experiences, and those experiences weaved in with marble and stone and glass ceilings. It all started to define who I was. And then one day, through just touching clay, I started to find my own power and my own identity. And it's been like full speed ahead ever since.
And I know you work on a lot of projects at one time. So I'm curious, like, are you planning on another project after this festival's over? Any exclusives you can give us? Spill the tea.
I'm doing around 10 projects, girl. I'm in freaking Missouri, Michigan, Albany. I'm cranking them out. I see where Black bodies are being, they're being hurt, where we are going through trauma. And if I can use my power through my sculpture as a point of conversation, connection, dialogue, and healing, I'm just there. I think the one thing I want people to know is that I'm not someone you commission. I'm someone you tell a problem or give a purpose. And if it has to do with what I'm interested in, which is Black bodies, I move time and I move heaven and earth to get that project to that space so we can communicate.
Thank you. That's amazing.
I love that.
Amazing.
Thank you.
And next we have Dami Lola. Let us know.
Hi. So my journey as an artist started since I was a kid. And then, you know, you would normally ask kids what they wanted to become. And then I always told my parents I wanted to be a magician. So I'd always been fascinated with colors, with feathers, with, a lot of aesthetics, right? And then the journey continued when I was in junior school, and I realized I was not interested in any of the logical subjects like mathematics, like who cares about numbers? And I would sit down and just draw and paint beards on pictures on my books and all of that stuff. And then I just realized that it was my path. And then I just needed to pursue it. And if I didn't pursue it, I would never feel fulfilled in this life. So I worked as a graphic designer for a long time. And then eventually photography called me. And then I answered.
And how did your parents feel about your pursuit in the arts?
Well, they've always been fascinated about, because I was different from every other kids. So they've always been fascinated about my choice. Like you would ask people and all the children, and they wanted to become doctors and lawyers. And you would ask this one, he wanted to become a magician. So they'd always been fascinated. So they knew they had a different kid, right? And then they supported me all the way, because they knew from a long time that this one was not gonna follow the
That's good to hear. Shout out to your parents for supporting you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not many African parents tend to do that, but shout out to your parents. And next we have Tepiso.
So my creative journey started in a very simple way. You know, I discovered a book by a photographer whose name is Santu Mofokeng, and it was called the Bloemhof Project or something like that. But growing up in South Africa, you know, my country has like a very volatile and violent history, and a lot of this violence was directed particularly at Black people. So the white photographers that were coming in and the foreign guys would consistently photograph in such a way that it made Black people in South Africa look dispensable and replaceable, and as it made them seem like they were tools for degradation, basically. Until I saw Santu Mofokeng's work, where people like myself were being documented in a way that's dignified, in a way that's respectful, and in a way that speaks to you at various levels. And then I decided at that point that that is the kind of history that I want to create for future generations in South Africa. I want to teach them that even though we have violence consistently being inflicted on us, we are still a great people. We are still born of marvelous and incredible bloodlines, and therefore we must document the extent to which we are marvelous. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Woo. Ryan, if I can, I just want to ask a question, because what you said was so powerful. I'm curious, like, how old were you when you took that information you found in that book and started implementing it? Because that is a heavy topic. That is just a heavy topic to like synthesize and understand and then start implementing. So like, can you just like walk us through that?
I think I was 18 years old when it happened, and it was at an interesting phase in my life where I was kind of between high school and university. So I was being introduced to the idea of kind of decolonizing as a personal project. So I was 18, I was confused, and I think I was ripe and in a space where I was ready to unlearn all the toxic things that I'd learned about my being as a Black woman, and to take on new ideas about how I should exist from here on forward.
Ooh, definitely looking forward to hearing more of your project.
It's powerful. That's powerful.
Yes. And next we have Demetrius.
Yeah, that's always hard to follow up with Tshepo coming up. But so my artist journey started out when I was a little kid. I just loved, you know, drawing pictures. I was very visual. I always had the family video camera. I was always taking pictures and drawing stuff. And of course, I erased all of our family photos from one vacation. And so ever since, I've been trying to make up for that with just taking as many photos as I can. And I loved watching movies as a kid. It always, you know, Jurassic Park and Men in Black. I must have watched those things at least 100 times. And I remember in middle school and high school, I loved making videos. You know, whenever a project involved some type of visualization, like make a short film or something like that, I got so excited about it. And I kind of just assumed everyone did too. And I had a really influential film teacher in high school, and he really just taught me the power of it. And so that led me to, you know, thinking about being a film major in college, and then producing just a lot of stuff when I was at Middlebury College in Vermont. And just, you know, honing my craft and just being a better filmmaker. And from there, I started to work for Middlebury doing videos for them. And I really started to question my own Black identity. You know, I think I get to partake in a lot of the privileges of being Black, but I don't face many of the consequences of that. So I started to ask myself, you know, where do I fit into this community? And I wanted to explore how Black people maintain their sense of self in predominantly white communities. So I made a film called Carroll Street, named after the street my mother grew up on, about how Black students, faculty, staff, alumni maintain their sense of self at Middlebury College. And from there, I wanted to keep exploring, you know, how do we keep our composure? How do we maintain our confidence when there is so much white normalcy around us? How do we fight against that? How do we keep our sense of self? And so that led me to Bacchanal de Afrique, looking at transportation specifically in how Black people maintain their sense of self when they're driving around Vermont. Vermont is a predominantly white place. And so how do we feel going from point A to point B when we're going to be the only Black person on the road?
Awesome. Yes. Your work is definitely a sight to behold. So I'm excited for people to get a chance to see that. And if they haven't, you better go over to bacchanaldeafrique.com and get your day pass or all access pass to go check it out, because it's definitely worth seeing.
Thank you.
And next we have Kiazi.
Yes. So my artist journey actually starts before I was born. It starts with my father leaving the Congo and making a new life for himself in the United States. Malonga Kaskulu was his name. And he just did a lot by way of building relations and connections with communities here in the United States and sharing Congolese culture. So I was a child growing up in, you know, rehearsal. He had a performance group. He started camps. He taught at universities. And there was no childcare in my household. I just tagged along with my dad. And I began drumming and playing different percussive instruments from the Congo kingdom. And I say kingdom, I'm talking about all of the countries kind of in that area at a very early age. So I went through a stage where I loved it. And then I also went through a stage where I didn't really like it, 11, 12, 13. And then when I came, you know, 15, 16, 17, I fell back in love with my Congolese identity. And, you know, since then, I've just been trying to continue the work that he and his and the rest of his counterparts started, and being a connection and a bridge between my community in the Congo and, you know, the community here in the States. So that's a little bit about my artistic journey.
That's really good. Kiazi, would you say your dad played a really huge role in your creative journey?
Definitely. He did. I think he was really interesting in the fact that he realized he gave me all of the knowledge he had. I think at that point, I kind of was like, okay, I know what we're going to do. I get it. And then my interest kind of started to wane. And so he then began to bring in other artists that would spark and kind of reignite the fire. So I think in being a very selfless person, right, you can only give so much in all that you achieve. And so if you really want to continue to fill that cup, once your cup is finished, you find something else to pour and to pour and to pour. And he was kind of a really, really good kind of forward-minded thinking person and being able to find ways to keep me interested and driven in the art. So yeah, his influence on my creative expression was great and beyond himself, because he realized when he couldn't give anymore, he brought in other people who could.
And quickly, in terms of where you're going after this journey or continuing on this journey, mm-hmm. know you mentioned that you're working on an EP or album next year. Any fun details you can share about that?
Yes, there's so many things I can share. So this is my first debut album, long time coming. The album is titled Tembo Kyangoma. One of the songs is actually featured as a part of my contribution to Project Bacchanal d'Afrique. It's one of my favorite songs. And so the beginning of the new year, 2021, in January, the album is coming out and I'm hoping to perform. I'm hoping to, you know, get you guys' feedback and see how you love it. But yeah, that's kind of the main thing for me. And I want to continue to kind of share music and continue to create. So more to come. You can follow me at Malonga Music on all my social media handles.
Nice.
Great. Is it going to be on any streaming website?
Yes, iTunes, Spotify, and then the rest. We're at that stage right now. We're finally in the final mixing stage. So yeah, all of the online media streaming applications will be on.
Nice. And next we have Ifayomi.
Hello. So my creative journey started young. My mother kept me very active in dance and choir. I probably was in choir my entire life. And my mom is a writer and an avid book lover. So She would take me to the library and have me pick out books. And I loved it. I loved that experience. And eventually she decided that I should do book reports on the books that I was reading, which I did not like at the time. But it grew my love for storytelling and narrative writing and really like ingesting what I was reading. So from there, I also did film in my church's summer program every summer. And the first narrative I'll say that I came up with was called The Serial Killer. And it was just about somebody going around and eating everybody's cereal in town. And I'm so proud of that when I think back on like how young and creative I was and where I am now and where I think I'm going now. So throughout school, just going forward, I was in journalism, went to college for journalism, newspaper. I got into modeling in college, still was doing music, performing live, all of these things I loved. And I always felt like, what is this one path? Like, what is the one thing? You know that quote, becoming the jack of all trades, master of none. Like, that just weighed on me. Like, what is the one thing that I have to decide as a creative? And I just realized that I loved all of these things. And the marriage of them happened in film. I could have my love for aesthetics and styling. I could write my narratives. I could have the music that I want. All of these things like existed, and that seemed so perfect to me. So now what I'm focusing on is continuing to create narratives that highlight people who look like me in a way that speaks to our healing and our joy, not our trauma. and just really highlighting our God nature and this sanctity and divinity that we have as Black people.
Amen.
Yes. Something that I feel like we can all relate to as artists, especially being younger, I feel like we've all hit that roadblock where we're kind of like, I don't want to do this anymore, or I don't today, or I don't want to, you know, we get to a point where we're kind of, I don't want to say lazy, but we kind of like give up on our craft a bit. But for some reason, it always comes back. It either finds you or you find it again. So I love that you mentioned that point. And now we have our girl, Taylor.
Yeah. So I always loved writing. I wrote in, I don't know if you all can see me. I'm gonna do this camera. So I'm gonna talk to you like my homies. I always loved writing. I wrote in diaries all the time. And my mom would pick the locks because I thought that these diaries were just like, those little plastic locks were just like indestructible. And so I would pour my heart out and then my mom would read them and I'd be like, dang, you know my whole life for real. So that's how it started. And then like small influences would come in. Like I loved Lemony Snicket books and I loved adventure and sci-fi and I loved battle rap a lot. And I love freestyling. And I would walk home from skating with my homegirls and she would start the Lauryn Hill instrumental and I just like start going off and we just walk home and that was our ritual together. I had moved to Oakland, but I never thought much about it. Like my mom always was like, Taylor, you should do something with this. I was like, okay, just another thing on the list. And then I moved to Oakland and I was just super angry one day, like so upset of just like all the social issues that come to mind when you think of social issues, especially towards Black women. And people were looking at me like I was crazy when I was like voicing it. So my first rage writing was like, am I crazy? And I was like, yo, this is hot. I gotta get this off of me. I'm hot. Like not even hot, like good, but like, ooh, this, I'm mad. Like I swear, like the pages were like burning as I'm writing. I went to a couple open mics and people liked it. And I was shocked because I'm screaming at them. And I think everybody kind of just looked at me with their hair blown back. And I was like, yeah, that's how I feel. That's, I want to get this out. Like, I want to, I felt full release, like no borders or constraints. And so that's kind of that, all of those stories and influences you'll find in my project.
But yeah, that's how the journey began. And I just started writing ever since. I'm like, all right, cool. This is therapeutic at this point.
That's amazing. I guess you and Tra can go battle rap, right? And go head to
head. Yeah. But you know what's funny? My work for Back in Our Day Afrique is completely not my aesthetic. It's something new. Like, I'm storytelling for real. So like my verses, like, just emotionally purging. So even the way that I perform is a lot different. So I'm looking forward to people to get to know me on like all these different levels.
That's amazing. Saving the best for last, Afatasi, the artist.
Hi, everyone. So I believe my creative journey began when my mom would take me to fabric stores. So I identify as Afro-Polynesian. My mother is from Western Samoa, which is a small, tiny island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. And my dad is a Black American. And we have a very small Samoan community in San Francisco. And there are times where we need to have traditional wear made. And for me and my sisters and my family, we would have to go to the fabric store and go and get the material and have a seamstress make these traditional clothings for us when we were younger. And then I began performing traditional Polynesian dances, we had to make the costumes ourselves. So that's how it kind of started. And I feel like the fabric store was like the one place that my mom would let me touch things, you know, like normally when we're like in like other stores, it was always like, no. But, you know, the fabric store, I was able to like touch the textiles. I was able to, you know, run my hands through the aisles and feel all the fabrics. And when I wear traditional Samoan clothing, I really feel transported. I feel something inside. And so I try and make sure that a lot of the things that I do in regards to textiles are honoring my Afro-Polynesian identity. And that is what I see myself, like that I see myself going towards that, especially since I have received so much great feedback regarding my Afro-Polynesian clothing and fine art tapestries. So, yeah.
I love that because I also love fabric. I mean, I'm not on your level, I'll just say, but I do love colors. I love fabric. And like, when I first heard about your work and your project and what you do as art, like, I didn't even know that was a thing. I didn't even know like textile art was a real thing. And then seeing your work made me feel like, wow, like you can really, it's like one way you implement fabric can be a completely different way you implement it in another setting. And I'm curious in terms of like where your journey continues on from here, like, and what venues or areas do you showcase your art?
I try and get my tapestries in different venues, just like everyone else that's a artist. I normally just wear my clothes. Like, I feel like my clothing is art. I just wear it and I feel like I'm the gallery. I'm all about wearable art. Like, people always, I feel like the clothing that I make and I wear, it always sparks a conversation and people are always like appreciative. I think my love for colors started when I went to high school and it was like the only, shout out Burton High School. I went to high school and it was the only San Francisco public high school that made us wear uniforms and it was like black and white. It was so depressing. Like, so I just love bold, bright colors. And also I source textiles from the entire African diaspora. So I have African textiles from Brazil. I have them from Nigeria. And also I have that same feeling when I touch those textiles as well, when I am wearing like my traditional Samoan clothing. And so I always am drawn to those fabrics.
Love it, love it. And, oh, sorry, Brian, did you want to say something?
No, I'm just, Afatase, I really love your drip today. I love the headgear. It's really standing out.
It really is. And I'm sure the audience feels the same way. So the audience, you guys just heard a little bit about, you know, these artists' creative journey. Please feel free to drop in questions on Facebook or YouTube. Share anything you found interesting thus far on social media and tag Bacchanal de Afrique or at
Fair. Yeah, we actually have questions here. Yeah, we have questions. So sorry, I'm just having my morning coffee. So we have a question for Tepiso from the audience. So because I'm learning my Xhosa, so this one is in Xhosa, a question came in Xhosa. Inkube yesiXhosa and Utata Madiba, uyimpelele njani impulelo yakho? So direct translation is Tepiso. How has your Xhosa culture and the successes of Utata Madiba influenced your art and your success?
That's a very interesting question. I think to begin with, like, it put a lot of pressure on me personally, because if you look at a lot of the very like famous or well-known freedom fighters in South Africa, the Mandelas, the Sobukwes, the Bikos, were all Xhosa. So for the longest time, there was this expectation that if you are Xhosa, then it means that you basically have it in you to like become this great person. Which I think I had to learn that I need to re-identify, I need to recreate a history that I can live up to. And what Mandela's legacy, what his life has taught me, is that every person is complicated, every person is complex, and so are their stories. And that is why I need to apply that type of thinking in the work that I create. So as a South African, I know the different facets of Utatu Mandela. I know the parts of him that were imperfect and the parts of him that were heroic. And I'm able to apply that to my daily life and to my art as well. And I think it's something that is important that we share with the rest of the world. You know, we put out that within our imperfections, there are parts of us that are meant to be great. And both of these things exist in duality.
Ooh, yes. I love that response. I think people can definitely relate to that. And I think it's important for people to realize that, like, obviously perfection doesn't exist. Like, we need the imperfections to be there to be a full human. So thank you for saying that. And just going on to our next question, kind of ties in there about what inspiration and what sparked everyone's interest to join Bacchanal de Afrique, the fellowship. Because the theme is very specific, it's transportation, and our theme is Me Soon Come. So what brought you here, and what about the theme connected to you? We'll go back to Traboli.
They say time is a healer, but time is taking forever. It's hard to endure when they wanna end your endeavors, sowing grains, no green in my garden, just growing pains, deeper than the departed, but they keep throwing flames, so I built walls, but the walls became crack addicts. I fill the holes, but still the whole world stares back at me. You see now, like, that's one of my pieces called The Truth. And I've always wanted to create. So when the idea of transport came, I was like, this is another chance for me to just push myself. But what happened, I got put out of my comfort zone and I created music that was more like vibrant and beautiful. And through the discussions we had, the journey of what it takes to be an artist, I was inspired when we were asked to reflect where we were and where we are headed as artists, where we started from as creators. And I realized Like sometimes we get trapped in our past. And so the project I created is called Safari, and it's just about the journey of the artist, how we move from places of, like, for example, the truth is such a, it's such a difficult thing to box in or understand. But when you get to other aesthetics like beauty and love and joy and fun, they can also be spiritual powers of their own form and kind. So like Bacchanal gave me that opportunity. So like in the beginning, I didn't know what to expect. It was just somebody suggested, would you be willing to apply for this thing? And then I met so many interesting people, and they opened my mind, gave me new perspectives. And so the Project Safari is just based around all these ideas and that I collected from you guys and the amazing artists that I met. So yeah, like my journey as an artist is what drew me to Bacchanal. I thought I'd be really like curious to present it for an audience.
And then just to follow up on that, me soon come, yeah. It means so many different things to different people in their own dialects. What does me soon come mean to you?
In Swahili, that means nakuja. So for me, it means I'm coming. Like, I'm not there yet, but I'm coming. I'm coming. Like, I'm just getting ready. You know, like there's always something to be unpacked and to unfold. There's unfolding in that. So nakuja is always, yeah, this motion and direction. That's what it means to me.
Word. thank you, Tra. Yvonne, do you mind telling us what drew you to participate in Bacchanal de Afrique 2020? And what does Misun Kam mean to you?
Well, what drew me, I think something happened right before I was asked to apply. I had cut my hair and I was starting to sport my afro. And a friend of mine said, wow, what does your husband think? And she was white and I had rage. I just was enraged. And I thought, God damn, I need something. And I was so angry. And then I received this note about applying to this festival, this fellowship. And the only thing I knew is it was black and brown brothers and sisters. And I said, I'm going to be there because it is black and brown. It is people from, I mean, we all have different cultures and we speak different tongues, but we have a great unifier, which is the color of our skin. And if you have been through trauma, and if you have a skin color like ours, there is always going to be something that we can find in common. So that was really important to me. And when I learned that it was about transportation, I really wasn't sure how I was going to apply to, like, what could I possibly think of to do? But I was doing research on AfroPics because I use a pick now for my hair. And as I was doing the research, I learned that the pick with a fist and with the peace sign actually was patented in the US by an Italian businessman in the 70s during the height of the Black Power Revolution. And it was really upsetting to me because it meant the economics of what we were trying to do. We, my black and brown brothers and sisters, we were trying to get money into our communities and it was going out. So I knew that given the time to talk with my brothers and sisters in this fellowship, I would figure it out. And during conversations, I learned about the erasure of the Underground Railroad system, the houses that allowed people, black slaves, to move from the South to the North to freedom. And that became a part of the journey for me. It became a part of what I wanted to do in my work. So when I think of Me Soon Come, I think about taking a moment, taking a little time to understand yourself. And maybe you don't arrive on time to your destination, or you don't arrive in the way that people want you to, or dress the way that they want you to, or look the way that they want you to, but you'll get there. and it's going to be all freaking right.
That's powerful. That's powerful. I really love your afro.
Thank you.
Me too. How dare that lady say anything?
Lady say anything.
Thank you very much. It's a source of great power. Source of power. All of us with our hair is a source of power. We can't forget that ever.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Long,
for
short,
that.
Kinky curl, however it is.
Yes, absolutely. Ooh, that got me hot just thinking about it. Thank you for sharing. Damilola, go ahead and let us know what drew you to the festival.
Hi. So what drew me to the festival, first of all, was the diversity in Black power that I saw, because it was a call for like artists from of Black origin, African origin, from wherever in the world. And I, as someone, I'm like completely African by blood, by mind, by like whatever. So that first drew me. And also the theme transportation particularly got me interested, because I mean, I live in one of the busiest Black cities in the world, Lagos, Nigeria. And transportation is like, you cannot speak about Lagos and not speak about transportation. You cannot speak about Lagos and not speak about the yellow buses, the Danfos. You cannot speak about Lagos and not speak about traffic. You cannot speak about Lagos and not, like, you know, it's all of that together. And Lagos has got like so many vibes. Like, we've got like some of the biggest musicians come from here, from Fela Anikulapo Kuti, from up until now that we have like Burna Boy and all of that energy. And then you get that all imbibed in transportation and all of that. So that drew me into it. And I had already done work in transportation. And yeah, that's what drew me. And Misunkom, in Nigeria, it literally means I'm still in my bed. Like, Nigerian time applies. Nigerian time is 2 hours later.
So yes, I'm coming... be honest. Thank you. Next, we have Sepiso.
Yeah. So I think I share the same sentiments as Yvonne, in that I was attracted by the idea that a group of Africans were creating a space for themselves, and here we were going to be allowed to be as African as we were.
I think
wanted as loud as I to participate in the fellowship. And also, like, I started thinking about the politics of transportation, because the theme is so broad and so interesting. I imagined that the types of conversations that we'd be having within the fellowship would be so engaging because of the idea around the politics of transportation. For me, the fact that that alone represents the positive ways in which, as a people, we are willing to move forward and rewrite the narrative. It's the beautiful prospect of expecting to arrive at a destination at any point in the future.
Nice, yes. And we definitely, throughout this fellowship, have had a lot of engaging conversations in our smaller groups surrounding these topics. Just quickly want to check in with the host to see if we have any other questions before we keep going. PYE or Ma, is there any questions from the audience side?
Actually, yeah, there is. Sorry, guys, I was just finishing off my painting.
You are lit, PYE.
I mean, they're inspiring me. I'm just painting as they're, you know, as they're talking. So this is a question for all the artists. So what challenges did you encounter while you were creating your Bacchanal projects? So any of the artists, and this came from a follower or an audience member called Play Cookie Selector. So shout out to Play Cookie Selector. All right, I gotta go back to my painting.
So I guess anyone could answer that, but since we're gonna go on to the project question next, we're gonna hold on that question. And then we're just gonna continue on. Next we have Demetrius.
So what led me to Bacchanal and Me Soon Come was, you know, living in Vermont, there's just not a whole lot of Black people here. You know, I just looked it up and there's about 9,000 Black folks here out of like 600,000 people in general. And so I'm always looking for chances to just be around more young Black creatives and just connect with them and learn from them and just take in all they have to offer. And so this was the perfect opportunity. And then on top of that, what our subject was for this project was transportation. And there was this pretty famous study that came out a couple of years ago about how Black and brown people in Vermont are stopped 4 times more than white folks. And I wanted to dig into that. I wanted to say, like, why is this happening? Vermont prides itself on such being a progressive place, as Bernie country, for God's sakes. But yet there is this implicit bias with the police force. And so I wanted to talk to other Black folks around here and say, you know, how do you feel driving down like the interstate or driving downtown? Like, do you feel visible? Do you feel seen? Do you feel like a threat? How do you deal with that anxiety that comes with transportation here and being so seen?
Well, that's very interesting to know that a town or city like Vermont can have 9,000 Black people out of 600,000 white people, correct me if I'm wrong. That's very interesting. That's mad. Kiazi, do you mind telling us about your project?
Yeah, most definitely. So am I talking about how I'm came to the festival, or am I going over my project? I just want to be clear.
Yes. Yeah. What do you do to participate in Bacchanal?
Got it. So I was first intrigued.
The Ethnic Dance Festival.
Where it's a festival that happens annually here in San Francisco. And I saw Afro Urban Society perform. And they had like, it was like 40 deep and with like drums and percussion. And they had everybody in costume. You know what I mean? And so I pulled NK aside after. I'm like, shit, like I didn't know that. You know what I mean? He was doing it like that. And so I'm like, look, like, you know, I'm here in the same, you know, geographic location. I'm a percussionist. I'm supporting everything African. So if you ever, you know what I mean? If there are opportunities to collaborate, let's do it. And so we kept in touch on an artistic, you know, from an artistic perspective after that. And she let me know about this festival, you know, Bacchanal d'Afrique, and that the theme was transportation. And so that's kind of how I was introduced through that, was through that performance that really moved me, you know what I mean? And to this day, I'm you know, the hot shit. So as far as transportation goes, as I mentioned, my father immigrated from Congo and had to travel across the Atlantic Ocean. So for me, it was always, in growing up here in the States, it was always looking like, okay, my home is Congo, but I'm here and I'm kind of sharing culture and seeing kind of how in African-American culture, there are different things that are similar. And, you know, so I'm just always making that connection to see what types of, you know, heritage and customs remained in the African-American community and what things, you know, were similar. And so for me, it was always about kind of transportation of culture through time and through space. And for me, Me Soon Come, I think about that like we 50 deep. So I'm going to answer that question, not from my own personal perspective, but from this cohort, Bacchanal d'Afrique 2020, we're like 50 plus deep. So to me, that's like an army, right? And you hear like the footsteps, doom, doom. It's like a force of nature. And we might be moving slow, but we're moving things. We're rearranging the landscape. You think about forces of nature like glaciers. They may take thousands of years, but when they go, they rip through that mountain. You think about rivers that rip through, and it's not destructive. It's reshaping the landscape. So for me, when I think of, you know, I'm a gardener. You think about baobab. That tree can take 600 years to grow, but it's moving and everything around it. So Misun Kum, I think about that from a collective perspective that, you know, regardless of what's out ahead of us, you know what I mean? And how slow or how fast we're moving, whatever is in our way, you can get out the way or you can jump on shit because we're not stopping.
Absolutely. We are not stopping. We're going to keep going. We're going to ride this thing. Ifayomi, let us know what drew you to the fellowship and festival.
All right. So just like Kiazi said, I think about Misun Kum as being this collective call. But I'll get back to that. So I initially was presented the information about the festival from someone who worked on something for me. And when I read everything, it was so on time because I had just finished a film called Omiero, and it was about the sacred waters. And I tied that to this travel aspect of the transatlantic slave trade and this ancestral travel that had happened through water and this communicative nature of water. So I felt like it was this collective call of healing. And also with me being from Detroit, I felt obligated. Like, we're the Motor City. We're home to the Big Three, which is the, you know, the three top U.S. car producers. Everybody wants to work at a plant in Detroit, which is, you know, where we make the cars. And when you're talking about Detroit transportation, there are a lot of issues that come up. Our insurance is one of the highest in the nation. But I wanted to take this time and this moment to create something that saw us in a lens that captured our journey, period, as Black Detroiters in this city and how we travel and how we move, because we so jazz and we so Detroit and I love us. So I felt like really obligated to take this time and this moment to show up and show out for Detroit, and to really create this continued call for this collective journey and this travel and this movement that I'm sure isn't specific entirely to Detroit, because I think this celebration aspect to Bacchanal speaks to something that all of us need to do as Black people in this time, in this moment that we're existing in, where we have to be reminded to celebrate our journeys and going and coming wherever we're going and coming from, like still finding these moments to honor ourselves and to celebrate and to find joy. So that's why I joined.
Amazing, amazing. Taylor?
Yes. My journey here, this year was crazy, as we all know. But the year before that, I had this like super glamorous job. I got flewed out to San Francisco to work in like the Devil Wears Prada kind of situation. And I thought I would love it, but I hated it and I quit. I ended up making my own organization called Gold Beams, and we started having events for Black creatives. And it started in my house, it was like 50 people. I'm like, whoa, this is a lot. And it grew into being like every month between 150 and 400 people, Black creatives, just being together, eating, drinking. We hired artists, we hired caterers, just art in all forms. But I had quit my job. So I ended up working like a million side jobs to help grow my business in different ways. I started teaching at Oakland School for the Arts, poetry, just to hone in. And then I started doing other things to kind of fill in my resume because I was nervous about like my experience part, right? So
this year, I've just been doing a million things, but not having a time to write. I'm a poet, I'm a spoken word artist, not being able to grow my skills. And so I was like, I need, just like I have all of these projects happening, I need something to force me to have something do. Like, I have to do these 7 pieces for this cohort. And not only that, like I said, I had never written centered around a theme. Like, it was always around an emotion, and those emotions always tended to be kind of either I'm talking shit in my New Yorker tongue, yo, or like I'm really emotional. And so I was like, how can I kind of can I thread this needle into a hole that's small, that's not of my choosing? And so that's the theme on travel. And so I ended up writing 7 pieces on how I evolved with my transportation, whether I'm walking, I'm Ubering, I'm flying. Each piece is named the transportation method, and how I just changed, but then how I came back. So there, it starts with walking, it ends with walking, and walking is 2 different things for me now. So that's what brought me here.
Beautiful, and congrats on your business.
Yes, that's my baby. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I see posts all about it on Instagram. So once I get flued out to San Francisco, I hope I can kind of connect with you on that basis and see what it's all about.
Flued out.
You know what it is. Did we want to finish off with Afatasi? Let's finish off with Afatasi. We can't forget you. We have to always save the best for last. Yes, let us know what drew you here and what Misun Kam means to you in your dialect.
Sure. So I am just very much like Yvonne. I wanted to be in a creative space with other Black artists. I'm fairly new to the art world, and when I would when I was accepted into shows for my tapestries, I always felt like I didn't belong there, and I always felt othered. I'm normally, if I'm not the only Black person in the room, I'm always the only Samoan person in the room, and definitely the only Afro-Polynesian person in the room. And so I feel that as always something that other people point out here in San Francisco. And so with that being said, I was grateful to find out about the fellowship and applied because I wanted to, this is my first fellowship, and I wanted to experience that with other Black creatives. My experience has been amazing. I'm also a huge sci-fi lover, and I felt that I always wanted to do work that was based off of my love of sci-fi, and I felt like I never had the chance to do that. So like part of my process was like finding ways that my culture kind of influenced my love of sci-fi. And I wanted to show you guys a picture, if you could see it. This is called a Fale Samoa, which is Samoan house. And this is literally one of the homes that like my mother grew up in. And so it has this like conical shape in it, like Samoans still live in house, like still build and live in house like this. And it's very similar to a lot of indigenous structures. So I put that in my spacesuits because they're very similar to like the space modules that got man to the moon. As you could see, there's that repeating conical shape, and it's also in my work. So in my work, Black Space, you'll see these repeating conical shapes because I really wanted to take it back to like the ancestors and indigenous, and how that like shapes and function definitely travel throughout time. And I wanted to, and so my spacesuits have these conical shapes in them.
Dope.
Oh, sorry, Emmy, sorry. And Misun Kam means to me that you wake up early just to be late.
We gotta be honest here. We got to be real, but it's okay. Now we're gonna go to the Padlet or the tag wall to see kind of different things that have been posted there. Some cool pictures, some cool comments. It should be coming up shortly. But this has been so much fun this far while we wait. Ah, look. Oh. Can we get it back up there?
Hey, so this is the Padlet. We just have a few artists. We have some posts up there, a bit about Detroit. Afutasi showing us the shapes of the homes. Just some stuff up there about some of the people's projects. You can check it out. Some highlights.
Nice.
There's also including some of the pictures from Shepiso's favorite photographer who he was inspired by. Yeah, we have some.
Can we see that?
If you go down.
Nice. Beautiful. I love our community. Like, I feel like we've really grown over the past, 3 months maybe, into like a real artistic collective. So I'm so happy that we have gotten the chance to do this. How about you, Brian? How has your experience been before we go into learning about these people's projects?
It's been an amazing experience. Was on a Zoom call every single Saturday. Was a far-fetched dream to me. I really didn't think that it would ever be possible. I could hear my friends talk about day-long Zoom calls, but I got to experience one and I really liked the experience. We grew as a family together as we got to know each other better. We got to know about each other's disciplines better. We also got to offer helping hands where we could. So it's been an amazing journey. And I'm sure this is not the last that they're seeing of us.
No, I definitely hope not. I definitely hope, and I think I've seen some people collaborate already on some projects in the cohort, which kind of leads on our projects for this festival. Starting off with you, Tra, like, let us know about your projects. Or your project and how it came to be.
Thanks. My project is called Safari. So it was inspired by one of the Zoom meetings that we had, which was about the journey of the artist. And locally, a lot of artists, like, art is not the main source of bread or income for many artists, but I just wanted to give the idea that abundance is possible for artists. So I travel all the way from Nairobi to my hometown in Nakuru. And I met a lot of artists in this small studio that come from different places. And I was like, guys, I have this project. And they're like, cool, let's start making. And we started creating. And there are people I had never worked with before. There's an artist called Kelly who I met in the core. And apparently she's from New Jersey, but her sister town has always been Nakuru. So she happened to be there doing her own project, and she just jumped on one of the songs and added background vocals. So the Safari thing just came together very, like, I don't know if I can call it synchronicity or serendipity, but it was very, very dope. And it was through this program that could happen. Yeah, so it's just amazing music, and I would love people to enjoy. It has different sounds, different landscapes of sound. It goes from experimental to dance to deep poetry and all those things. Yeah, cool.
Can't wait to jump to that. Yvonne?
So my project really has to do a lot with Black history. It had to do with the Afropic, and it had to do with me looking at the roots of it, that the Afropic comes from Africa. It was originally sculpted in wood or carved out of wood or stone, and it would have these beautiful shapes to it. It wasn't originally a fist. I mean, there's nothing wrong with the fist, but it wasn't a fist. It wasn't out of plastic. It was these beautiful materials to me, what I consider beautiful materials. So I wanted to incorporate that learning. And I also wanted to incorporate coming from Africa to the United States, that journey, and the metal rods of the pick being patented in the United States by two African-American men. So I wanted to take that aspect of it and bring it to the United States. And then I wanted to incorporate into it my hair, which is very important as a woman of color. I wanted to incorporate that hair was also used to signify a journey. So our hair was something where we would sometimes put rice inside of it. So when we crossed over, we would have sustenance. We would also sometimes, when we crossed over from Africa to come here as slaves, it was our sustenance. We would also use our hair sometimes to carve paths to freedom or to use it as maps. So to me, that these things were so purposeful and so important, and they were so represented in what we call the Afro pick, or what we call the comb, or what we call, you know, this the tool that we use to shape and style our crown jewel. So that to me was so important, and that's what I wanted to get across in this project. And one of the things I just want to give a shout out to is because Traveli and I were in a group that we worked on together, that his he not for this particular thing, but he did this piece, this rap, Hello from the Other Side, and I don't know why, it just stuck with me a lot, and it was also something I played that inspired me as I was creating. So I just want to shout out. And so many of the people in this cohort have inspired me in so many ways. So I just want to put that out there.
Yes, I knew the collaborations would be running deep. Next, we have Damilola. You're on mute, Dami.
Sorry about that. My project was basically about one of the first forms of public transportation in Lagos, which is somewhat phasing out now. It's called the Molwe, and the title of my project is Molwe, the Last Generation. And one of my focuses on this project particularly was the rugged and the doggedness of this vehicle. I liken it to the strength of an African woman. She goes through so much, but she comes out strong regardless. So as much as it is phasing out now, and we have only a few of them left, as in the last generation, as the name of the project says, I'm also looking at ways where modern forms of transportation can incorporate the strength of this mode of transportation into their structure, into their activities and how they operate.
That's deep, Damilola. Thank you. Thank you for that. Tatiso.
Yeah. So my project that I created for Bacchanal is called Kufamba Ikubona. It's a Xitsonga phrase. Tsonga is one of indigenous South African languages in South Africa. And basically, it's a phrase used when old people or elders try to share their expression of shock. So when something happens and someone says, Kufamba ikubona, it means, wherever you go, you will see amazing things. And ideally, it's a movement between past and present, because I believe that as physical beings, we are carriers of both our past and present. So I wanted to look at how public transportation spaces in South Africa carry silent ghosts of people who were violated, who had violence inflicted on them by apartheid and the volatile history that happens to be a well-known part of South Africa. And so
it's a movement between past and present and looking at the spectacular between the amongst the mundane, basically.
Beautifully said, Sapiso. Beautiful.
And these are just snippets of the project. If you want to get the full experience, the full feeling, the full vibe, you need to go to bacchanaldeafrique.com and get your day pass or all access pass so you can really get the feel for everyone's art. Next, we have Demetrius.
Thank you. So my project, it's called Vermont Black, and it's more of an emotional kind of visual art piece, and it examines the contributions of Black Vermonters over American history. You know, Vermont graduated the first Black American. We also, Vermont Senator also enacted historically Black colleges. We were the first state to abolish slavery. And I wanted to look at, you know, the Underground Railroad and the different parts of it, as well as, again, the historical contributions of Black Vermonters. And I juxtapose that with the lived experiences of current day Black Vermonters. You know, I interviewed a professor, a business owner, some artists about, you know, what's it like being a Black Vermonter right now as far as transportation goes.
And just to follow up, and this is for the rest of the artists that speak as well, we did have the audience question regarding challenges that came up while you were making your project. So Demetrius, did you have any while creating this or any roadblocks?
You know, not so much. People are really willing to talk to me about this stuff. I think just, you know, finding the right people and finding people to talk to. You know, I only had my own network to work with. And so I had to figure out, how do I extend that? How do I get people to say, okay, who do you have for me to talk to next? And so that was the biggest challenge. Like I said, there's only 9,000 Black folks here, so I got to find them all.
And next we have Kiazi.
Yes, so I'm a musician, and it would be not right for me not to. So my project, Ntali Jazz, from the Congo Kingdom to Congo Square, highlights the horn culture in the Congo Kingdom, and then the horn culture in New Orleans, Louisiana. And it basically takes, as far as transportation goes, it looks at the transportation of these culture, or this culture, these customs, this affinity for horns through time, and then also physically through the transatlantic slave trade, with the, just the resilience of the African people to continue to keep certain elements of culture. And so, again, I mentioned this song is captured on my album, Tembo Kyanguma. But it was an awesome project because it really forced me to connect more with the Western horns and really transform the melodies of this traditional horn to you know, the artist that I was working with to collaborate. So it was a great great opportunity.
That's amazing. If I owe me.
So my project is a film, and it's called Ceremony of the Journey. So when you think about ceremony, you think about the celebration or something that's worth being honored. And what I wanted to do was take this moment to really focus in on Black Detroiters, Black commuters, and show them in a way that highlighted their reverence in this journey, in the way that we connect with one another when we travel, the places that we travel to and from, our river walk that we go to, it's warm, our transit center that probably everyone in the city has been to get where they need to go, and really connect these things and these moments and these shots of Black Detroiters with the intention of ritual. And the movement and intention that exists in everything that we do. So, yeah, that's really it.
Thank you for that. And Taylor, go ahead and tell us about your project.
Yes, so I wrote 7 pieces. I'm so in love with nostalgia and my past. And when you're young, like babies are almost like kind of like puppies in a sense, where those are like the two things that give like pure joy. Like when a dog is happy to see you, baby's happy to see you, they're like, oh my God, I want to hug you, I'm gonna love you. Like that's how me younger, like my heart being so open, those are really pure feelings. And so I tapped into those as I do in my writing. The hard part was like I had these 7 stories. I was like, lit, bet, like, okay, this is all right, did it. And then there was a challenge to, all right, well, can you put it to music or can you make the video? And I was like, what? Music? And so I ended up doing that. I ended up playing around with my voice and yelling and screaming and crying and like being very theatrical. And as you can see in some of my pictures, that's like the vibe. And it just felt good to marry or just to revisit like my Black culture and nostalgia through the project.
Amazing, Kayla. Last but not least, Afatasi.
Sure. So James Baldwin once said, I imagine it'd be easy for any white person walking through San Francisco to imagine everything was at peace, because it certainly looks that way on the surface. You've got the San Francisco legend too, which is that it's a cosmopolitan and forward-thinking, but it's just another American city. My project is entitled Black Space. As a textile artist and Afrofuturist, I created 2 spacesuits using EVA foam, stretch African print fabric, and vinyl. The space helmet is here and it lights up. I added tap lights. And see,
ooh, that is
fire. They have the space helmets are made out of paper mache and EVA foam, and the cutouts in the helmets are inspired by Polynesian tattoo. Black Space is a photography series slideshow featuring 2 Black female Afronauts, and it seeks to dispel the myth of San Francisco being a liberal and progressive city in regards to its Black residents. The photos were taken in spaces in San Francisco where Black space has been minimized, annihilated, and where there are traces of us still there. The spacesuits are the vehicle in which the audience is being transported throughout Black space. So I think the video you're seeing right now is me with a X-Acto knife, because I had to cut out every single little thing. And I'm gonna take it off so you could see the Polynesian tattoo symbols. I don't know if that's a good, but, and they all mean something. So like, this is like our hieroglyphs here. Like this is the Fala mat, and that means wealth and prosperity. So.
That is so fire and so freaking creative. That is mad. And we were gonna go into our group project, but because as we say in my African church, time is gone, time is far spent. And we have to keep the train moving. We got to keep the plane moving. So we're just going to check in with the host one more time, Maul or PYE. Is there anything from the audience that they want to know from any of the artists?
Yes, Afatasi. I just got inspired. I made my own spacesuit hat. I'm ready to take on the Bacchanal Afrik spaceship. So this was a question for Tyler from the audience. Do you use your emotions, or say for this project, how much of your emotions did you actually explore in creating your project?
Where would we be without PYE?
You're like literally the coolest. I did not use a lot of emotion. I use more of that like nostalgia and my peace from it. And I really connected a lot of dots, so it was more of like evaluating things like, wow, this really did mean something to me. Oh shit, like I do carry this. Or you know, you just look at all the layers in your life that makes you and your thoughts you, and my accent it and my passion for Blackness that, because I had such a bomb ass experience being Black and being my Black culture. Like you just see how it just comes out in everything that I am. So
a lot of doctors, it's almost like a math problem, like that little meme with the lady and the triangles and stuff. It was like that.
Thank you for that. Brian, we are at the end of our journey.
It's so hard to say goodbye, you know?
To say goodbye to yesterday. You know.
Come on, choir. Come on, choir.
You know? If you could summarize your experience at Bacchanal in one word, what would it be? Let's go.
Perspective.
A piece of.
Mind opening.
Monati.
Inspiring.
Movement.
Expansive.
Friends.
Community.
And then we'll go to Brian. Let us know your word.
Informative.
I'll say enlightening. PYE.
Look at what they made me do. Inspiring.
We have another host, Maul. I don't know if you want to share a word.
Yeah, I would say expanding.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. As always, like we mentioned, this is our very last artist talk. So we thank you so much for joining us. You can check out everyone's work at bacchanaldeafrique.com. Obviously, follow the Instagram and Facebook page, you know, subscribe on the YouTube, you know, like, comment, share, all of that. But also definitely purchase the passes so you can get a chance to experience everyone's work. Tomorrow, we're going to have the US release of the performance experience. You got to be there to check it out. And yeah, follow everyone on Instagram. You can find everyone's Instagram again on the website. And connect with us. We're so happy you guys all joined. So I would say have a good night. Morning, afternoon.
Whichever time zone you're in, blessings.
I-Cabin Crew izomane yehla kenyuka kwama aisle ixosha wonke udodi nezikhwama zemali nama nezokucwebezela. Please make sure you take all your belongings with you. Anything left behind will be auctioned at the upcoming yard sale. Ungashiyi abantwana nozithanda zenu.
At our location. Please remain seated until the craft has parked at the gate. At no time in history has a passenger beaten a craft to the gate, so please don't even try. Also, we are currently recruiting people to clean the spacecraft. So, if you wish to volunteer, please stand up before we have come to a stop. Thanks again for flying with us today. We hope you enjoyed giving us your business as much as we enjoyed taking you for a ride. We appreciate your applause, but frankly, we prefer cash. Welcome to Planet Bacchanal.
Did we land or we get shot down? Because that landing was, I don't know about that.